One fall, 10-minute time limit now. Tracy Storr moving out against Jake the Snake Roberts. And, brother, you talk about an opponent who is ominous. Notice that, coming right off the ropes, back leg trip by Roberts. Anything to give him the edge. That's the thing about Jake. Cross chest ride, brought him back to the canvas. I must say one thing when you were talking about Mr. Valiant bringing a new dimension to tag team wrestling. He has indeed.
He's an exciting guy. He really is just full of fire, what do you call it? He's an exciting wrestler, and he's a little unorthodox, as you see, but he goes out and he gets the job done, and when you look at the partner that he's got, Pistol Pez Watley, they look to me like they're an unbeatable combination.
They are indeed. I think perhaps one of the toughest combinations I've seen in a long time. Meanwhile, Jake the Snake continues to punish Tracy Storr. Storr's got himself a lot of problems here.
Well, you can hear that one pop all over. I tell you, you throw in the forearms, you throw in some of those slaps sometimes that chop the flat of the hand. It can do more damage than a closed fist. The power comes right off the wrist. And with Jake the Snake, I tell you, he's always trying to be very clever, as his name implies, I guess, maybe deceitful or slithering, I think, as you said. But he's the kind of guy that engages each opponent and then tries to decide what psychological move, what sort of move physically is going to intimidate his opponent. And in this case, he's looking at Tracy Storr as being a younger and inexperienced man compared to Jake the Snake. And he's just going after him physically. He's just assaulting the man.
No question about it. He's pretty well dominated the situation since the match began. Storr has tried gamely several times to move effectively against him. Has not been able to do so. Now, in the NFL, they'd call that spearing. There's no question about it. He used his head as a battering ram in that particular instance.
The difference here is that there's no pads to protect anybody. Tracy Storr is out there. He's highly vulnerable. There are no rib pads, there are no shoulder pads, there are no hip pads. And when that shoulder of Jake the Snake or the head comes in, it's painful.
No question about it. And point well made. The what you see is what you get, so to speak, in professional wrestling, because these men do not have all of the extra protection as you would have in, well, in baseball with the helmets, also in hockey and in football. Speaking of football, it's nice to see Marcus Dupree finally is apparently all squared away now, and he'll be back in action next year, and that's certainly a pleasure. Jake the Snake didn't allow the pin.
You know, I look at Jake the Snake, and it seems to me as though he's trying to give somebody a message. He's trying to show he can totally annihilate somebody. Now, he's worked on the back, he's worked on the side, he's worked on the chest. There he goes again with that spear that you mentioned, right into the upper shoulder area and the chest. He's not trying to beat anybody at this point. I think he's just trying to punish Tracy Storr.
Set an example, if you will, so that all future opponents have an idea of what's in store for them. And, of course, Jake the Snake, like all other wrestlers, looking to become the very best in their sport, going after that, the National Heavyweight Championship or the World Heavyweight Championship. These are the things that these men all strive for, is to become the individual, just like the Orioles went on to win the World Series. Tracy Storr exposed to the midsection of Jake the Snake Roberts, and he could have him in trouble here. Let's find out. Arm whip into the park. Ooh. He struck like a cobra that time, and Storr was just a bit overconfident.
Well, you know, there again, we've seen it on several occasions where the Snake has really pounded somebody pretty good and then just given them maybe 30 seconds to a minute relief, respite, and as if to say to the guy, or make the guy think that he had something going, and maybe with one last determined effort, he could come out on top of Jake the Snake. But it's another psychological ploy by Jake the Snake, because he knows he had the guy in control the whole way.
Speared him once again, and now it is Jake the Snake, sort of a Russian sickle, sort of an unusual way to put it on, but And Storr, unable to get back to his feet. Jake the Snake. Bring him around. Now Storr finally gets back to his feet. Boot into the chest area of Storr, and Storr's in trouble. Storr staggered back against those ropes. And it is virtually all but over for Tracy Storr. Jake the Snake. No question about the victor in this match, Jake the Snake Roberts.
Champion Ric Flair in action against a very, very fine competitor in Jerry Gray. Let's go to Charlotte. And there he is, Ric Flair, very, very flamboyant individual. His robes run anywhere from $3,000 to $5,000 a piece. He keeps himself in tremendous physical condition. Fact of the matter is, Ole, here's a man who had offers from about 12 different universities. Finally went to the University of Minnesota, where he was on the football team and also all-state in wrestling. So the man has got tremendous credentials.
He's got a great athletic background. Of course, as do all of the wrestlers. And we've talked about it many times. To be a wrestler takes an awful lot of time and concentration, and you have to be a great athlete.
All right, Ric Flair now, as it is Jerry Gray slipping away from him. Flair very quickly hooks him once again. Notice the way he utilizes his legs as well. They had a three-quarter Nelson there in a great find. Now a standard ride position. He had the near arm posted, then hooked the forearm, took him over to his back. Gray is able to get that shoulder off the mat. And it is Flair switching, floats over the body. And Gray got himself into the ring ropes, and that forces the break.
Well, at this point, Flair is just trying to feel his opponent out. He's trying to control him. He wants to see what it's going to take. And he's using an awful lot of amateur moves. He's using some good professional moves, going around, grabbing an arm, grabbing a leg, taking the man down. And, of course, in order to control somebody, you've got to put him down on the ground. You've got to get him on his backside eventually for that pin. So right here, Rick has done a little bit of control. He's tried to see what his man is going to do, and it looks as though now he might be able to try for a pin, and that's what he's going for.
Sullivan Bar on the arm, and it is Jerry Gray who manages a good high bridge and keeps himself from being pinned, but it is Flair pressing in on him. Gray again trying to get closer and closer to those ropes. Again, utilizing those ropes if he can, but he gets back to his feet. And now he does. He goes directly to the ropes, puts his leg through, and referee Stu Schwartz calls for the break.
You know, we're looking here, as we mentioned, the former world heavyweight champion, Ric Flair, and we talked about the good things that they've done and the people that they've visited and so forth. I don't want to forget that when we watched that thing from the Scottish Rite Hospital, the Children's Hospital, that the two men that were involved on that particular day were Pistol Pez Watley and our national heavyweight champion, the national heavyweight champion, I should say, Brett Wayne. And they're both tremendous men, both tremendous wrestlers, gentlemen, athletes, or what have you. And they gave their time and enjoyed doing it, as you could see. And I think that they should be commended. And there's one other thing that we had forgotten to mention last week. There was a man that was responsible for the filming of that little segment. And his name is Craig Leathers. And we appreciate all the work that he's done, too.
No question about it. It was a fine piece of business. Jerry Gray looks like he's suffered a nose injury on this and maybe having some breathing problems now. And it is Flair backing away, giving him an ample opportunity to move back in. Once again, collar and elbow, and it's Flair with a side headlock. Referee Stu Schwartz has had a relatively easy time of it thus far because these men have been observing the rules and regulations pretty well. Gray now caught in a beautiful chop by Ric Flair that drives Gray back to the canvas. Gray backing away on his bicycle now, and it is Flair, a snap mare to the canvas, and Jerry Gray has his problems as Flair begins to put out some heavy artillery on Jerry Gray.
As you notice, the nose is a little bit in need of repair right there. And in wrestling, sometimes I wasn't quite sure how I got my nose busted. I wasn't sure how a finger was broken because in the action, things happen. And when you get done, you take stock of yourself and you just wonder what in the world, what you're trying to through. In this case, I'm sure Jerry Gray is going to have a few questions to ask himself when he gets back in the dressing room.
And it's one of the marks of the profession, so to speak. Obviously, any person who engages in physical combat of any kind, be it football, baseball, hockey, or what have you, injuries are going to occur.
One difference, if I might point out, if we were another sport, I'm not trying to belittle anybody, but I would say this. In many cases, a game might be stopped, or time out might be taken, substitutions might be made. Wrestling is the one sport where an injury has no meaning in terms of the referee. You just continue wrestling until it's so bad, unless it may be at a point where the referee may want to stop it. But for the most part, small injuries, a broken nose or a finger or a rib, the match continues.
And much to the detriment many times of the opponent. Beautiful spinning toe hold into the figure four by Ric Flair, former world heavyweight champion. And it is Gray conceding very, very quickly. Referee Stu Schwartz calling for the bell. There you see Ric Flair emerging as the victor. And may I just say, of course, we watched this in slow motion. A good, beautiful, high vertical suplex by Flair. And it is Gray to the mat and the submission hold. A gentleman that certainly now needs no introduction here on World Championship Wrestling, Jake the Snake Roberts.
You know, I sit back there and I watch you show 4 minutes of the ex-world champion, Ric Flair. Why? You tell me why. Why don't you show what's happening here? Because this is where it's happening, Jackson. It doesn't matter if it's Ric Flair, Harley Race, Brett Wayne, Ronnie Garvin. Brett, I know your mother told you not to come and wrestle because you're not well. Garvin, he wants to grab about somebody holding a rope. You should have learned by now that I'll do anything it takes to get where I want, and that's to the top. And nobody's going to end my reign. It's my destiny to be the king of pain. Brother.
Here's a commercial word.
Next Wednesday in Columbus,
in
Georgia.
Germany,
tomorrow night.
Pistol Pez Watley and the Boogie Woogie Man. Listen, Boogie Woogie, we don't care about dancing. You won't be dancing on us. And after the match, you ain't going to be singing either, brother.
Wait, we're bringing them belts down there, you guys. And we're done. You guys are going to be crying. And there's one more person. He knows who he is. He better keep his nose out of our way.
Eyes with Wildfire Tommy Rich. Absolutely the last time they'll ever meet in the ring. The ring will be enclosed by a 10-foot-high steel chain link fence. And Paul Ellering will be suspended in a cage over the ring. National Tag Team Championship. The Road Warriors champions defend against Pistol Pez Watley and the Boogie Woogie Man Jimmy Valiant. National Heavyweight title. Brett Wayne defends against Jake the Snake Roberts. Mask versus mask. Mr. Wrestling against Wrestling 2. Loser must unmask. TV title match. Ron Garvin, champion, against the Great Kabuki, managed by Playboy Gary Hart, plus more exciting matches tomorrow night.
In Brunswick, Georgia, at the Aquarama on November 8th, and Wednesday, November 10th, in Gainesville, Georgia, at the Mountain Center. And tomorrow night, the very last encounter with Rich.
That's right. I want that camera to get a close-up. Get a close-up on the Mad Dog. Let me tell you something, Wildfire. Tomorrow night, in the Omni, it's all coming down to an end. The last time, a steel cage. They got a top on it. Have no referee in it. It's going to be locked. They got my manager in another cage, hanging 30 feet above the cage. Rich, we did a lot of talking. A lot of talking. There's nothing we can do here or anywhere else.
And after it's all over, Ole Anderson and Paul Ellering. Team champions, there you see them. The Road Warriors moving out against Chief Joe Lightfoot and Mike Jackson. And brother, I'll tell you what. I have yet to see in a team as impressive as these Road Warriors. They are absolutely overwhelming when they go into that ring.
They're big and they're strong and they're getting a little bit smarter. You know, they start that match, both of them in the ring at the same time. Now, technically, that's illegal. But for a certain period, a count of five or so, they can get away with it, and there's nothing that can be done legally. And they're just getting clever enough to understand how to utilize the rules to their advantage.
Jackson in behind his man, and look at the tremendous example of that upper body strength. Jackson caught him with a drop kick, drove him back, then drives the knee to the midsection. Jackson firing with all the power that he's got, but he just, it's impossible to move that much bulk. Ooh.
Well, he's a big man, and again, we're talking about big wrestlers, big men. The Road Warriors, both of them weighing somewhere in the neighborhood of 275, 280 pounds apiece. And as you can see, they're both very heavily muscled. Just nothing like it. They're wrestling a little bit more. I don't know why. I don't know why they're trying to change their style, or if in fact they are. But I've noticed recently that they're doing a little bit more wrestling, but they still have a tremendous amount of just brutality.
I was going to say raw brute power is the answer for it. There's no question about that. Chief Joe Lightfoot caught him with a good chop coming in, but they're retaliating now in kind, and the tag is made. The animal and the hawk, brother out 30 what? They typify exactly what you would think of in the matter of being road warriors. Again, Lightfoot getting a lot of punishment here. I think perhaps the reason that we might be seeing some change in their methodology in the ring is the fact that their opponents are beginning to make moves that are a little more deceptive and skirting away from it a little bit more, although Jackson's cross town is in a lot of trouble.
And the Road Warriors are also changing their tactics a little. You know, there have been, using their ring strategy a little bit better. They're tagging in and out more often than they used to. I think they used to think they were, well.
High military press on Mike Jackson, well above his head, and with those 22-inch biceps, great upper body strength, they're able to punish their opponents with almost reckless abandon. And they are perhaps a little bit more studied and a little bit more cautious than they've been in the past. I wonder if the fact that Pistol Paz and Boogie Woogie Valiant have teamed up could have any bearing on this. It's difficult to say. Lightfoot now explodes lengthy, and he may have them in. Oops. They reversed the situation again very quickly.
Well, there are a lot of tag teams, and we've seen the Armstrongs, Briscoes, the Funks, Wrestling Number One, Wrestling Number Two. There are a lot of great tag teams around, and I'm sure any one of them would give the Road Warriors a heck of a go and might even prove to be a winner in a contest against the Road Warriors. But right now, the Road Warriors are the team to beat. They're the ones that have championship belts, and until somebody beats them, we have to respect them for that.
No question about it. Chief Joe Lightfoot jammed into that far turnbuckle. Referee Scrappy McGowan watching Lightfoot using a headbutt and smashes to the midsection once again. Lightfoot tries to roll away, tried to get over and make the tag, and he's being blocked very effectively. Cut off at the pass, if you will, and the Road Warriors again totally and completely dominating the situation. Off the ropes, he catches him with an elbow. There the tag is made, and it is the Hawk and the Animal now. Continues to punish. Coming off the ropes once again, the Road Warrior. High backdrop by Lightfoot. Lightfoot tried to set him if he could for a rolling reverse, but not, however, he was stunned. And now Lightfoot rolls to one side, makes the tag with Mike Jackson. Mike Jackson charges the ring. Mike Jackson caught him to the side of the head. Good move by Jackson. However, the Road Warriors begin to try and overpower him once again. Catches him with an elbow coming off the ropes. Jackson is down. The Road Warriors tag up. They are tagging up more.
They sure are. They're moving real quick. Again, for 280 pounds to see those guys move around like they do, to me, it's an incredible. Look at this. Look at this one.
Ooh, full press and then down across the knee of the other Road Warriors. A count of three, it's over. It is all over, and the victors are the National Tag Team Champions, the Road Warriors. Heavyweight champion Brett Wayne. And Brett, who has suffered a severe laceration on the head, moving out against Jason Walker. It'll be interesting to see if Walker tries to figure that's the weak spot and goes after him.
Well, I don't think that there's any question. I'm sure that he owes it to himself, I suppose, if nothing else, to do the best that he possibly can against a national heavyweight champion. The amazing thing here, it points out what we talked about before, and that is the intestinal fortitude that's displayed by so many wrestlers, and in particular by this young wrestler here, Brett Wayne. He's done what anybody would have said was impossible 2 or 3 months ago. He's managed to be a national heavyweight champion. And even though he's not the size like the Road Warriors, he's not a big man like Ted DiBiase, he's got that big heart as we saw in that film, and he's got a tremendous wrestling ability, but I think the biggest asset that he's got is just the stick-to-itiveness, the big heart, a true grit.
I'm reminded of a wrestler who's now retired, who was about the same size and had that same kind of tenacity, and I know you're very familiar with him, Greg Peterson.
Well, Greg is one of many who had to compensate in some ways. They're large men, 230 pounds, 240 pounds is not a small man. But by today's standards, there are so many men who are over that 300-pound mark. When you compare them to somebody like Bundy, 420 pounds, you've just got to have something else going for you. And there's no doubt in my mind that there are an awful lot of wrestlers that we see, in particular this one right here, Brett Wayne, who's just got more doggone gumption than I've seen in a lot of people in a long while. You know, we talked, Wrestling 2 and myself talked about trying to persuade Brett Wayne not to wrestle on TV, but he did. I talked to him all this week not to wrestle the matches, but you couldn't stop him. He got banged up, he got pushed around a little bit in some cases, but he never got put down. He always came back, got that hand raised again, and I think that although the winning is important, in Brett's case, how he played the game was even more important.
I have to agree with that. I might note that his leg does seem to be somewhat improved this week, but he's certainly showing the marks of the combat that he's faced during the last days since we saw him here on TV, and now Jason Walker in trouble. Good suplex by Brett Wayne. Wayne moves in, lateral press, and Walker utilizing those ring ropes to the fullest advantage. Nice to have Kathy Carr from Birmingham, Alabama, here today with us. Monroe Woods at the Carrollton Convalescent Home, our best to him. Cleveland Archer is here from the Bahamas. C.T. Beasley from Urbana, Illinois. Dick Smith from New Jersey. Folks here from all over the country watching the matches here on World Championship Wrestling. And it's Walker now going after that hurt leg. Walker now beginning to punish that leg of Brett Wayne, and Wayne showing the effects of it. This may caught him with a forearm coming off those ropes. So Wayne has that explosive quality that is so necessary to be a winner.
He sure does, no question about it. He's a competitor. You know, how much pain must the kid be in right now with that leg injury that he's got? Forehead lacerated like we can see, and still, he just isn't going to quit. I tell you, no matter who takes him on, they're going to have their hands full.
No question about that. When you go to battle with Brett Wayne, you might as well bring your lunch because you're going to be there a while. And it is Walker. Good block by Wayne. Counteracts that time, gets a good full body slam. Brett Wayne fires him off the rope. Caught him. Ducked to one side, caught him with a forearm, got the pinfall.
Well, there was a Mr. Wrestling who was here for years, Tim Woods. Everyone knows him, loves him. You come on the scene saying, I am Mr. Wrestling. How can you make this statement?
Just simply because I am the best. When somebody's called Mr. Universe, that means they are the best, right?
Yeah.
When it comes to wrestling, I am the best.
Mm-hmm. That's your whole explanation for it.
That's my whole explanation. I am the best.
Okay, Craig, you have a question for Mr. Wrestling?
Well, you've been locked up in quite a feud with Mr. Wrestling 2 lately. And I'm curious, what is it that you're trying to prove to Mr. Wrestling 2?
Well, I don't have to prove anything to anybody. When I get in that ring, everybody can see that I am the best. Mr. Wrestling number 2 is hot because he knows that I am better than he is. He knows that his time has passed.
Okay, now you, Heidi Walker from Chattanooga, Tennessee, said that you appear to have a lot of skills as a scientific wrestler, and you show this in the ring, but she wants to know why the mystery, why you just didn't come out, again, back to this question, why you just didn't come out without a mask, and if you're the greatest wrestler in the world, and do it on your own credentials instead of hiding your face.
Instead of hiding my face, I don't use this to hide my face. You see, sometimes to get a horse's attention or something, yeah, you have to use a 2x4. This here is my 2x4.
So it's a psychological maneuver to thwart your opponent's strategies.
With this, everybody has to look at me, and they will see that I am the best.
Okay, a comment by Mr. Wrestling. Number 1, I guess you're...
No, there's no number. I am Mr. Wrestling.
You're Mr. Wrestling. Okay, remember if you have a question.
Oh, the Georgia. Worldwide Championship Wrestling has their own television champion by the name of Ronnie Garvin. But I, here in the Mid-Atlantic in the worldwide area, have the National Wrestling Alliance television champion. That is the most popular, the most prestigious television champion in wrestling because we represent the National Wrestling Alliance. And anytime Garvin or any other champion of any degree would like to come against the great Kabuki, the National Wrestling Alliance heavyweight television champion, come and get us, brother, because he's had it for 7 months. He's toured all of Asia, Pakistan, Germany, and France. And let me have anyone to tell me that Ronnie Garvin, even though you're from the Superstation, you're not a super champion. The only super champion is the great Kabuki, National Wrestling Alliance television champion.
You see, Kabuki. Now, Deaton, a big man out of Texas, tall, rangy, and a very tough individual. But as you can see here, the great Kabuki is certainly well in command of the situation. He has dominated this match, and it is referee Stu Schwartz checking once again, looking down at their shoulders. No, it's Tommy Young. I'm sorry, not Stu Schwartz. All right, Deaton fires to the midsection. Kabuki. Notice the Swedish cravat applied to the back of the head rather than coming around to the opposite side, an oriental version of that. Kabuki, of course, who enters the ring in ceremonial attire that has been passed down for generations in his family. He is a man indeed steeped in a lot of tradition. This match, of course, taking place in Charlotte, North Carolina. Gary Hart making the statement that Kabuki, of course, is the most popular television champion. And that, I think, is certainly a debatable point. His popularity certainly is not what I think what Mr. Kabuki or Mr. Hart thinks it is. Deaton caught again by Kabuki, driven to the canvas. Notice Playboy Gary Hart in the corner. Outside the ring, watching carefully. He claims, of course, again, there's that cravat, but applied to the back of the head rather than to the front, as it is usually applied. And he drives his man over. Deaton, again, able to power that shoulder off and keep away from a pinning combination, but Kabuki has a tenacity and a drive that is difficult indeed to stop. All right, Deaton catches him, and that was at the belt line. Catches him again at the belt line. And you see a shot from over the shoulder of Gary Hart. Hart has been highly successful. There's the neck breaker by Kabuki. Kabuki also has the capability of emitting sort of a strange green fog from his mouth that has rendered a lot of opponents helpless. Again, you see the signals being passed by Gary Hart to the great Kabuki. Kabuki, who rarely speaks. Again, Deaton to the midsection. Notice how Deaton, there's no wasted fat on this man whatsoever. He is a fine athlete and a great competitor, but he's got his problems, and it is Kabuki now being arm whipped in the... Oh! Caught him coming in, and that one all but ripped his head off. And again, it is Hart signaling Kabuki. Kabuki up on that second ring rope, down across, chops into the back of the neck of Deaton. Deaton now fires back, and I'll tell you what, this fellow's got great second effort. Not able to get the pinfall, moves in very quickly again. And again, it's Kabuki firing Deaton off, and again, using his feet so very effectively. And of course, he does this in all of his matches. Catches him once again to the side of the head, drives Deaton into the turnbuckle, and Deaton is down, and that one stunned him rather badly. Kabuki now moving up. on that top rope. And it is Kabuki catching him with the claw, driving him to the mat. Kabuki has him down. Has him down for the pin, and now Young having trouble getting him to release that hold. Gary Hart moves in and forces the release. And so the great Kabuki, he emerges victorious. We'll see this again in slow motion. Notice the way he leaps to the canvas, catches him with that claw across the head, catching both of the temples, and drives Deaton back to the canvas for the victory.
A little bit emotional now. It's getting heavy. We're talking about a kind of match I've never been in my life. We're talking about something that's really heavy. We're talking about a Wildfire and a Mad Dog in the Omni one more time, just a little bit away, tomorrow night. Tommy Rich, I'm coming after you. They got the top on the cage. They got my manager over top of the cage, too. But that's not going to stop the Mad Dog, because I'm going to keep crawling, and I'm going to keep biting, and I'm going to keep going and going. And tonight in Chattanooga, Tennessee, dog collar match. Get ready. The Mad Dog is coming.
The thousands of letters we get asking about arrangements to come here to WTBS to watch the matches, all you have to do is call area code 404-524-6567, and you can make those reservations in advance. Admission is free, but we do need to have reservations in advance, so please call if you're planning on coming here to Atlanta. Right now, I want to take a moment to talk to Snake Roberts, because I have been studying his record recently, and he has developed the unenviable reputation of injuring more competitors in his young career at a faster rate than any other wrestler in history. The NWA is now really scrutinizing that DDT, as you call it. Mm-hmm.
Well, anytime there's an invention, Gordon, everybody looks down at that invention and says, well, that can't be right. That shouldn't have been done. What would have Thomas Edison done if somebody says, hey, light bulbs don't look cool? Well, let me tell you something. You go ahead and investigate the hold. It's perfectly legal, and it's perfectly lethal. And as far as hurting people that get into that ring, I would much rather hurt them than have them hurt me. It's like a piece of clay. Some people can mold it into a piece of art. Some people can't even roll it into a ball. Well, I can do it all. And Gordon, if you've been investigating my career and the things that I've done, then you should know that my record in Georgia and in the tours is 29-0-3.
On the Best of World Championship Wrestling. Yes, another from the Mid-Atlantic area. Happy to include these matches in our program and many from all other parts of the country, too, in weeks ahead. Dick Slater, Mr. Excitement. He's something else. Right now, he's in a side headlock that he gets out of, slams his opponent into the ropes, and greets him coming off the ropes with an elbow smash. Dick Slater, the unpredictable one. A judo chop there to the throat, and Larson's down, slowly getting back up. And Mr. Slater on the attack early in this match. The fans all over the country have seen him. He's a man who comes on strong at all times. Dick Slater. We're glad to have him on this program. This side headlock here by Richard, man from Tampa, Florida. Larson turns that into an arm twist, but then Slater literally bangs his way out of it and has Larson back on the mat. Headbutt by Slater. As you can see, when he's showing no mercy at the moment, stomping on his opponent's throat. Hip toss by Slater. Ron West, your referee. Dick Slater. A boot to the neck by Slater. Larson trying to fight back now, come to the right to the midsection, but Slater an elbow smash to the head, and another. Again, Larson trying to counter it, but it's hard because Slater's gotten the best of it early in the match, and he can smell a victory. Slater taunting his opponent now, as he's done many times in the past with opponents. Slater, he takes on all comers. body slam by Slater as he's pulling up in the air. Goes to the backbreaker. Has it on the canvas, spins off again. Seems to be more anxious here to apply punishment than to win the match at this moment. Seems to feel absolutely no problem with winning it. Here's a shoulder breaker. Rams him into the corner, into the turnbuckle. Still has him up. That's a tough move. It's been called the Oklahoma Stampede, that particular hold. Variation of it. Mr. Excitement, Dick Slater, being warned by the referee, but he is jubilant. You can feel this. He knows he's got his man where he wants him, and despite Larson's efforts to come back, at least at this moment in the match, it's been all Slater. Delicious opponent steps up on the lower rope, tosses him back on the mat, goes for the pin, and gets it. And in very dynamic fashion, Dick Slater has won his match over Larson. And I think we're going to get a chance to see a little slow motion here of the unpredictable one in action. There you see him coming back off the ropes. He has weakened his opponent throughout the match. And then spinning him backwards off the motion in almost a back suplex has him down on the mat. And so your winner, Mr. Excitement, Dick Slater. The World Championship Wrestling, the Briscoe brothers, who've attained such outstanding accomplishments as World Tag Team Champions. They've been great collectively and individually as a team and as individuals, with Jack having been a former NWA World's Heavyweight Wrestling Champion himself. Jack and Jerry Briscoe from Oklahoma. They were both outstanding collegiate wrestlers, and they've come onto the pro ranks strong. They've become two of the outstanding competitors, and are up against Bret Hart and Gene Ligon as we continue Best of Championship Wrestling. And you can see this match came from the Carolinas. It was shot on location in front of an outstanding crowd, and we hope you'll enjoy all the action of this match and all the matches on this program today and every week. A good takedown by Jerry Briscoe, who now tags with brother Jack. Stomp. Jack is left-handed, but he's very ambidextrous. He can wrestle neatly and well with either hand, and of course he's one of the quickest, pound for pound, I'd say one of the strongest and best wrestlers to ever come on the scene. He's world champ at 235 and hasn't gained much weight since then. He's about 237 now. That rear chin lock by Jack Briscoe. Crowd watching intently. And of course, here in Carolina, like all over the country, avid wrestling fans turn out to see the top professionals compete. And when you mention top professionals, you always think of Jack and Jerry Briscoe. They tag quite often, and they tag very well. This is Jack tagging with Jerry, and Jerry back into the fray. Front face lock. Neat takedown by Jerry Briscoe. Still applying the pressure, and so far, at this moment, against Hart and Ligon, it's been all Briscoe's. Strange things happen in wrestling matches, though. Sometimes, rising to the occasion, the underdog competitors can really give you fits and turn what looks like an apparent defeat into victory. So, in a wrestling match, anything can happen. There's a little double teaming. Now Hart into the action. Hip lock takedown by Jack Briscoe. And now, quick to, his anger is very quick. Jack starts blasting him with the left hand, a knee lift, tags again. You notice the time during the ring is really not very off. They just keep tagging very often. He keeps himself fresh. Stomp to the back of the neck by Jerry Briscoe. Snap mare by Jerry. And now he's got his opponent in deep trouble. Almost got it. Had the count of two. Jack and Jerry Briscoe, the Best of Championship Wrestling, originating in Atlanta and seen all over the country in billions of homes. We hope you're enjoying it. And now, as you see Jack come in, Jerry neatly just backed off, held the opponent at bay, and Jack comes right. Oh, a neat move by Jack Briscoe. It's almost a fireman's carry in reverse. He lifted him, spun him to the mat, goes into his figure for a leg lock. This is a submission hold. Referee asking, Jack's got it, this may be it. Calls for the bell, the submission hold did it. Jack Briscoe was the figure four that both he and his brother used so well and so convincingly, have won the match in just that fashion.
You know, in every sport, of course, injuries are expected, and many times, however, injuries can be so debilitating that eventually they begin to affect you emotionally. And I can't help but feel, perhaps, Mr. Sawyer, that emotionally, perhaps you're just a little bit...
There's a lot of emotional things going on in my life right now. A lot of things happen. A lot of people in my life that I see, they ain't seen in a long time, I see. And it's bringing back memories, bringing back times when I was a little boy, bringing back times when I think I might grow up to be a bigger boy. You know, I sometimes sit back and I think, yeah, I'm the mad dog, and I'm the best there is, and I never denied that, and I've always said it, and I always believe in it. But get that camera up here on me, and you'll see life has changed my life has changed me. Wrestling has changed me. Tommy Rich, you have changed me.
For watching the best of championship wrestling. The announcers on this program are employed by Georgia Championship Wrestling Incorporated.
And welcome to another hour of World Championship Wrestling. Let me start off by telling you that next week we have a very special championship match, One Fall, One Hour. We'll tell you more about that later on in the program. Right now, though, let me bring in a gentleman that, showing the marks from a pretty doggone tough battle this past week at the Omni here in Atlanta. A lot of people might be surprised to see him back here in action so quickly. I am not, but I still marvel at the way athletes are able to recoup from injuries.
Well, you know, Gordon, I think all athletes are under tremendous strain and tremendous pressure, and I like to think that maybe we're just a little bit different in the sense that we're able to take that pain. You look at a football player who's injured on a Sunday, unable to compete or practice all during the week, and yet the following Sunday, he gets ready to go, and wrestlers have to do the same thing. As you say, you marvel. Well, I sometimes do, too. It doesn't mean that the pain isn't there and that there aren't a bunch of hurts with us, but this is our job, and we do the best that we can, and that means that we have to be here. We have to be ready to wrestle.
And talking about being ready to wrestle, today we're going to be seeing Mr. Wrestling 2 in action, also Tommy Wildfire Rich, the Road Warriors, and a host of others, including a good friend of yours, Pistol Pez.
We got a lot of good ones today, and right now we've got a match in the ring with a kid who's really, really done well, and I'll let you take it.
25th, the suspension on one Ted DiBiase has now been lifted.
Well, we know that Ted DiBiase is hot on the trail of Tommy Rich, and of course several people. He's made the statement that he wants to have the belt, whether it's the world or it's a national heavyweight title, and he makes no bones about it. He's a tough competitor. The suspension, as you mentioned, was up on October 25th, and we do have a few words from Mr. DiBiase by videotape.
We do indeed. Let's go now to this exclusive interview with the man whose suspension has been lifted, Ted DiBiase, and he videotaped these comments for a release at this time.
World Championship Wrestling, first you fine me, now you suspend me for 5 weeks, thinking that it's going to put a cramp in my style. Well, let me tell you something. I'm a man in championship wrestling, in a wrestling world that can go any place I want to go with my ability. I'm wanted all over the world, and I have an open contract right now to go to Japan. So I'll just go to Japan for 5 weeks, but I'll be back. And when I come back, I'm going to pick up right where I left off. I told you people that I was going to hurt Tommy Rich, and that's exactly what I did. I do what I say I'm going to do. And I've got another man in mind when I get back. And when I come back, I'll hurt him too. If it has to be in the confines of that ring, And to keep myself from being suspended further than that, I can do. I am the greatest scientific wrestler you've ever seen. But the difference in Ted DiBiase now, as I told you people before, is that I don't care about being Mr. Nice Guy. Whatever it takes, anything it takes to win, to put that money in the palm of my hand, is exactly what I'm going to do. Where is Tommy Rich right now? He's laid out somewhere wondering what happened to him because he's a nice guy. Well, this is not a nice guy anymore. You're looking at a champion. You're looking at a winner. And when I come back, people, I'm coming back to stay. And oh, yes, naturally, I'm number one. And I'm going to be number one here and everywhere that you can see this face on World Championship Wrestling. So I'll take my suspension. I'll go to Japan. I'll go wherever else they want me because I am in big demand. And when I come back, I'll be back to stay.
Well, of course, he did, in fact, go to Japan, and I might point out that that shows the kind of resolution this man has, and obviously, well, he's not here today, but I hear he's on his way.
Well, we expect him any moment, I'm sure. I don't know when he'll arrive. We haven't had any word officially from Ted DiBiase, but I do understand that his tour is over in Japan, and he talks about the many places that he can go. I have no doubt that there are a lot of places that would might like to have a wrestler of his caliber. But I also question the way he wrestles. I'm also concerned about the things that he's done in the past. We'll be watching very closely for Ted DiBiase's return. I think this time, though, we're going to be watching him in the way that he's going to have to wrestle. He's going to have to wrestle according to the rules and the regulations that are placed upon him, and anything else won't be tolerated. We'll send him back to Japan.
Sunday, November 6th at 8:30, championship night for the NWA World Heavyweight title. Harley Race, 7 times world champion, defends the belt against Wildfire Tommy Rich, himself a former world champion, the special referee, Pistol Pez Whatley. National Tag Team Championship, the Road Warriors champions against the American Dream, Mr. Charisma Dusty Rhodes, and his partner, National Heavyweight Champion Brett Wayne. The Incredible Man from Sudan, Abdullah the Butcher, against the Mad Dog, Buzz Sawyer. The Great Kabuki takes on Boogie Woogie Man, Jimmy Valiant. National TV title, Ron Garvin against Jake the Snake Roberts, plus 2 other matches. Sunday the 6th, the Omni. Be there!
National Tag Team Champions going out against Ben Terrell and the Black Bronx Chief Joe Lightfoot. Lightfoot very quickly hurtled out of the ring. Terrell, who's out of Alabama, has a background of high school wrestling and Golden Gloves boxing, played football, but Rush, he is being overpowered right now by these road runners. And I mean they are punishing him. He's giving away some weight here and some size, but he has just had no opportunity whatsoever to move against them. Almost tore his head off with that one, and the Road Warriors just continue to pulverize any and all opponents they step into the ring with. They have the full body slam. A Road Warrior with a clubbing right hand to the side of the jaw. Tell you one thing, Terrell has proven he can take a punch because he has been punished unmercifully thus far in this very, very short match. And he has taken everything they've had to offer so far. There they go. Oh. Mercifully made the tag. Chief Joe Lightfoot staggers the Road Warrior. Lightfoot exploding with tomahawk chops. And now the Road Warriors retaliating. They were stunned momentarily, no question about that. But now they begin to dominate the situation once again. These men are like redwood trees.
Well, they're more than that. They're like mountains. They're two of the biggest men in wrestling. I don't know what in the world's going to be done with them. And they're just getting smarter all the time. They're doing those tags in and out, which are so essential to be a good tag team. They've got that brute strength. They've got the size. They're gaining that wrestling ability, which they apparently didn't have to the extent that they do now. They talk about being in the bars in Chicago, and I'm sure that they beat a lot of people just with their brute strength. But now they're getting some sophistication to their wrestling. They're watching it now. They're both in there at the same time on occasion, but if you watch real closely, they get out, one gets out before the count of five. So technically, there's nothing that can be done.
No, they're staying just within the limitations. No question about that. An elbow now down to the pectoralis majors of Chief Cho Lightfoot and referee Strappy McGowan, sending the Road Warrior back to his proper corner. Now Lightfoot fires back but catches the knee to the side of the head. And Lightfoot, a tomahawk chop, rolls over, makes the tag with Ben Terrell. Terrell, as he came through the ropes, was beset upon by the Road Warriors, and again, they have him completely under control.
A kid like that, I would hesitate to wonder why he would want to control.
And that one almost tore the body in half. We might get a chance to see that in the slow motion, and if we do, you'll see what I'm talking about. The impact of that massive
foot. 8:30, bull rope match, the American dream, the tower of power, Dusty Rhodes, clashes with the Mad Dog, Buzz Sawyer, and for this match, Paul Ellering will be chained to Tommy Rich. National Heavyweight Championship, Jake the Snake Roberts goes after the belt held by Brett Wayne. The Road Warriors clash with Wildfire Tommy Rich and Pistol Pez Watley, plus two other matches tonight. Cincinnati, be there.
Snake is one of the greatest wrestlers in the world today. A man who every time he gets into the ring wrestles with about the same amount of conscience as a fox in a chicken farm. Now the world is a demented society, and Jake has had problems communicating with society. But Precious Paul fully understands all the ramifications and stipulations of contracts. So Jake, I have for you two contracts, one for the world heavyweight television title and one for the national heavyweight championship.
This man can do so well.
He handles the paper problems, the things that I have trouble with. Right here, I have no problems, which I will show you, Soli. With my insidious mind, Jake the Snake will go to the top of wrestling.
Now let's take a look at Jake the Snake Roberts in action, and we'll go to the ring. I might point out that the one contract for the National Heavyweight Championship, I understand, will be on television here on World Championship Wrestling next week. One fall, a one-hour time limit. So whatever you do, make your plans to be watching World Championship Wrestling next week. As you see, the National Heavyweight Championship on the line. Jake the Snake Roberts going against the National Heavyweight Champion, who is, of course, Brett Wayne. One fall, 1 hour. Good kip-up by Mike Jackson. Jackson driven back into the turnbuckle that time by Jake the Snake Roberts. Good move by Jackson, and Roberts down. Jackson back up on his feet very quickly. And Jake the Snake having his problems coping with that. Well, it was... Jake the Snake closes in again, taking advantage of Mike Jackson's momentary lapse as he was looking toward Precious Paul Ellering. Now, that's a bad combination, in my opinion. Paul Ellering and Jake the Snake Roberts. Roberts, of course, does have a bit of a communications problem with society, and Ellering obviously is going to handle that aspect of it and let Mr. Roberts handle everything in the other way. He hooks the arm and then hooks the chin at the same time. And so it is Jake the Snake. There you see Paul Ellering. And he's showing the marks of the battle he had with Ole Anderson. I think Ole explained it rather well, however. That can jam the hips and the spine. I think Ole explained quite well the fact that... how these men as professional athletes have to go out and compete, even though they are in great pain. I know many times I've seen Dusty Rhodes, when it amazed me, when I knew what pain he was suffering, and yet he'd get in the ring and give that 110% that is so critical. And it is Mike Jackson right now taking the brunt of a full body slam.
Give it up.
Underhooks the arm, then crosses the keeping that chin twisted and Ellering outside the ring, taunting Mike Jackson. As long as he doesn't touch him, he's all right. Paul Ellering. Initially out of Melrose, Minnesota. Mike Jackson now beginning to explode and has Jake the Snake Roberts in trouble. No question about this. Mike Jackson beginning to... Ooh. Roberts struck like a cobra. High backdrop that has Jackson in trouble. So Roberts, who looked like he was being stung by a mongoose, suddenly struck back. Jackson powers out before the count. Jackson, a ripping right hand to the side of the jaw. Catches him with a boot to the midsection. High hip toss by Jake the Snake Roberts. Six feet four, about 250 pounds, and Jackson coming off the ropes. Jackson to an inside cradle. Roberts powers out. Roberts struck. Jackson again gets him. Lariat by Roberts that time. It is all over. We'll see if we're going to get a chance to see that in slow motion. Five wrestling courses.
I've got enough, Gordon Solo, Cincinnati, Ohio. Dusty Rhodes, you're the one and only. But I'm the Mad Dog, and I'm the one and only. We're going to get it on in Cincinnati, Ohio, Dusty Rhodes, because I'm bringing everything that the Mad Dog has. And then when I take care of you in a Crimson Tide, and I leave you laying on the floor, at Duma the Butcher, you're supposed to be the meanest, the baddest thing that ever walked. But you're looking at the Mad Dog Butcher. You're looking at the Mad Dog Dusty Rhodes. You're looking at the man, the next world championship.
Riverfront Coliseum tonight in Cincinnati. 8:30 in Cincinnati at Riverfront Coliseum.
Tommy Rich, everybody thinks that you being handcuffed to me is a big deal.
Well, we'll just see how big a deal it is in Cincinnati tonight. Talk to me, Jim.
Don't you just love it? Athens, Ohio, you're going to love it. Huntington, West Virginia, you love it. Huh? Don't you like to see something a little bit different? Well, here it is. So why don't you come on and see what the snake can do? And now that I have this
Battle round, Creek, Michigan, we're coming your way.
Cincinnati. And the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes, tonight in Cincinnati. And the Mad Dog, Buzz Sawyer, in the blue front, getting set to move out against Bob Brown. Now, here are two men who are very, very similar in body structure.
Well, they are. Both men are very heavily built. Bob Brown has pretty much it many times with the shoulders and the chest. But look at Buzz Sawyer. Buzz Sawyer is also a tremendous amateur wrestler. And I sometimes think of him as a guy that maybe just took the wrong road, because he's got a lot of wrestling ability, we know that. He's got that vitality. I think I mentioned to you, Vim Vigor and vitality. And certainly Buzz Sawyer's got that. The direction, with the help of Paul Ellering, I don't agree with, but you can't deny that Buzz is a heck of a competitor.
No question about it. Paul Ellering now adding to his stable, if you will, by picking up Jake the Snake Roberts, and that would be an interesting tag team combination. Nation, Snake Roberts and Buzz Sawyer.
Well, it would be. And maybe a combination like that might be interesting going against somebody like the national tag team champions, the Road Warriors. That would be an interesting situation.
I wonder if we'll ever be fortunate enough to see that. I was also thinking about the combination of Brett Wayne and Dusty Rhodes facing this kind of a combination.
Well, again, when you start mentioning names, all of a sudden we've come up with several different teams and combinations that could prove to be very exciting. The one thing you look at here, no matter what we think about Buzz Sawyer, we've mentioned so many times to control your man, certainly Buzz Sawyer does that. Probably as well, if not better than anybody.
No question about it, and he also uses the legs extensively. The legs, of course, being the strongest muscles in the body.
Ooh.
A forearm, a rabbit punch to the back of the head, and then drives the knee into the deltoids of Bob Brown. And Brown coming up rather slowly. Brown fires to the midsection. Sawyer fires back. All right, again, grapevining with the leg, and it is... It is Sawyer maintaining control of Bob Brown, keeping him on the mat. Remember, this match is one fall with a 10-minute time limit. Referee is Nick Patrick, who is a fine athlete in his own right, no question about that. I was talking to... internationally famous Jet Dragster Doug Rose yesterday, and the consensus of opinion was that this man, Buzz Sawyer, is as dangerous a competitor as he's been in the ring in a long, long time, and he is certainly proving his point here with a total front chancery on Brown, keeping Brown very much under control.
That's what you got to do. That's the mark of a good wrestler. Buzz Sawyer may be a little misdirected, and he's got some problems of his own, I'm sure. But as we say, what he's doing...
Brown hurtled out, and he came down on his hip and his leg, and it amazes me that he's even able to get to his feet. He is having his problems coming up, and he is really favoring that leg. He came down right on those femoris muscles and the point of the hip, and he's back into the ring, but he is not moving.
He's in a lot of trouble. He's stunned. He's a guy that's just operating on pure instinct right now. You can see that look on his face, Gordon. We're not too far away from him, and looking at his eyes, they've just turned to glass. I think Sawyer right now could beat him, but instead he's going to make sure that when Brown gets done with this match, he'll remember for a long, long time that he was against a guy that could beat him and is really punishing him.
Precious Paul Ellering standing by, watching him passively. Belly to back to play in a high bridge. Got the count of three. Got the count of three. Perhaps we'll see that again in slow motion. I don't know. If they haven't, we will. Yes. All right. Watch him very carefully. Now, Brown, completely dazed, completely staggered. And it's Sawyer in behind his man. Notice the low center of gravity. Caught him from the waist. High, high. Belly to back souple. Then bridges up very quickly, driving Brown's shoulders to the mat and scores the pinfall.
Tokyo, Japan, and see Harley Race in action. Well, I guess we're going to take us a second or two to get to Tokyo. There we are.
It's a long way away, Gordon.
It is indeed. All right, we're hearing the introductions being made at this time.
All right,
right, the announcer now describing the situation. Jumbo Saruta going up against Harley Race. I might point out that, of course, in Tokyo, Japan, and throughout the entire country of Japan, it's not unusual for 30, 40, and 50,000 people to be on hand for title matches.
Well, they have the capacity. They wrestle a lot in the outdoor stadiums, and whereas we wrestle indoors, so there's a little bit of difference in that respect. But on occasion, I think that you down in Tampa have wrestled in the Tampa Stadium and put that type of numbers in the stadium. For us, the World Championship, for the most part, we're wrestling in the arenas, and so 10, 12, or 15,000 people is the norm.
And a doggone good norm, I might add, too, is an average, and is Saruta. And exactly, the as you heard the commentator just say, it looked bad for a moment for the champion, but Race was able to bring those knees up just in time. Notice the host of attendants around Saruta. He is clearly the favorite in Japan, and everybody there that night was hopeful that he was going to be able to take that world title away from Harley Race. But Race is a man of fantastic intensity.
Well, we talk about people coming back. There's no question when we're talking about a man like Harley Race, having won that world title seven different times. He's the definition of being able to come back. He meets an awful lot of competitors all over the world. When you're traveling like he does to Europe and to Africa and to South America, to the Asian countries, the islands, and then here in the United States, every time he gets in the ring, he knows.
Quick to take advantage of that situation as well, and so Harley Race emerges victorious in this World Championship title defense against Jumbo Saruta in Tokyo, Japan. We hope that you enjoyed our brief tour overseas. Talking about people who electrify other people, however, this man, the Boogie Woogie Man, Jimmy Valiant, is something else again.
Well, he is, and right now we're going to get a chance to see him again. People here in the studio audience really reacted well to him. And in the arenas all around the country where I've been personally and watched Jimmy the Boogie Woogie Man Valiant, the effect has been the same. Very electrifying. He's just an unusual performer, an unusual wrestler. Crazy, but crazy nice. And the kind of guy that when you watch him, you just can't help. It's kind of infectious. You can't help but be excited along with him.
Whether it's wrestling, singing, dancing, you name it, this man does it. And he does it with a great deal of intensity. Let's watch him.
Thank you.
taking off after Tony Davis and Pat Rose. And these Road Warriors are indeed have to be the most awesome tag team combination I have ever seen. Brother. Caught Tony Davis coming off the ropes, and how long this team will last. Pat Rose is a good, solid competitor, but he is giving away height, weight, and size.
Excuse me, Gordon, we're talking about how big the Road Warriors are, and I had many times commented that it's difficult to find anybody that would be as big as the Road Warriors. But I think today we may have found somebody who is not only as big, but might just be a little bit heavier.
I would be curious to know.
Well, I think you might know him very, very well. Without mentioning a name, does the American Dream mean anything to you?
Well,
I'm sure it does to everybody, and I'm certain that the American Dream has been watching these guys very, very closely. And when the Road Warriors put out those challenges, I think that I know Dusty Rhodes well enough to know that he's not going to turn his back. He's going to be right there accepting every challenge. And another thing that I might find, I think, very interesting is if the chance were given to Dusty, I'd sure like to see what might happen to Mr. Bundy's $15,000. That would be quite a challenge.
And knowing Dusty, catches Pat Rose coming in, and Rose catches another flat of the foot on the back. Dusty doesn't go out of his way looking for trouble, but I'll guarantee you one thing, he'll never back away from it. And I think Mr. Bundy's $15,000 is not too safe.
Well, I think there's a couple of things that are in jeopardy right now. Possibly the National Tag Team Championship belts, $15,000. But right now we're looking at the Road Warriors, and they're as awesome as ever. Big, strong, getting better and better at their ability to wrestle, tagging. They don't stay in there too long at any one time. They're always moving, and they're just awesome.
Catching him with a knee once again. Pat Rose in a lot of trouble here. And that's dangerously close to a choke on that particular rear chin lock. He was under the chin. However, he broke it early enough as they made the tag. And again, it is Rose taking the full brunt of about 280 pounds. I would imagine their combined weight has to be about 560.
Well, there's no question about it, Gordon. 560, 70, or 80, somewhere in that neighborhood. We're talking about an awful lot of weight. When the two of them get in on one person, there's just hardly any way that a man can come out of it. But if you notice, when the referee starts to count, one of those Road Warriors gets out before the count of five. Everything that you're doing, whether you like it or not, and I don't like it, it's still legal. It's still technically allowable, and the referee has no choice but to just watch this punishment that's being taken by their opponents in the ring.
No question about that. He does call for the break on this one. And again, as Ole just pointed out, they do break. They make the tag, and out by the count of two on that one, Pat Rose. And he tags up with Tony Davis, and brother, the Road Warrior on him before he could even get in the ring.
Ooh.
Down on the point of that shoulder. And this man is not going to be moving around too well tomorrow, I don't believe.
Mr. Gordon, he's got him set up for that guillotine.
Lariat has him down. It's over. It's over. The National Tag Team Champions, the Road Warriors, are the victors in this match.